Hello everybody, hello folks, or I could say Python stars present here. So this is my first PyCon with respect to its India chapter. I hope you have, you know, gone through the proposal. So the topic for the talk is understanding how caching works in Python. You could call this caching or the actual caching. So in more or the similar ways, both are similar, I feel. Yeah, so just a quick intro about myself. I am a software developer at Barclays. I'm just a fresh grad. I've completed my 3 months of job. And yeah, so that's pretty much about it. The primary fields of my interest are machine learning and data science. Basically, that's something everybody wants to do. So yeah. Yeah, so it's always, you know, essential to understand the genesis of something which is, you know, starting or something which is just growing. So I would like to talk about the genesis of evolution with respect to PyCon India. Yeah, you may be wondering, I have a talk on caching and I'm talking about something which is quite weird. Yeah, so just a few questions, you know, so is there somebody who can answer all my questions? Then probably I perhaps consider him like he knows everything about caching. Yeah, so the question is, when was the first PyCon conducted? Okay, so it's not just the year you have to specify, it's the year, the month, the date, and the day. So is there anybody who can answer all the 4 questions? Yeah, so I was also on the same stage, you know. I too cannot answer all the questions when I first looked into it. So there's this website, PyCon India. So at there, they have mentioned a timeline, which is like they say they have started it in 2009. So yeah, so I searched on Google and I found the results. So the when it was started is 2009. Where it was conducted is Bangalore. And the dates are 26th and 27th of December. And the day was Saturday and Sunday. Oof. Was it necessary? No. Now, since you all are aware about this thing, like all the questions, if somebody asks you the same question twice or the second time, you will be able to quickly answer the question rather than referring to Google, right? So that's basically the caching. So you are using your own memory to recollect the answers for the saved question, for the question. And you are not referring to a Google server to get the answers. So that's basically the primary concept of caching, according to me. And yeah, to move ahead with the slides, just a second. Yeah, so the throwback was answered by me, and I guess you all are aware now when PyCon India basically started from its inception. So yeah, this is a pun intended. When I searched on Google PyCon India 2000, I was typing, it showed me 0, 4, and 5. But on the side, it was written 2009. So I don't know what Google is trying to show according to its search engine algorithms, whatever it is, but it was quite surprising. Anyway, so let's move further. Yeah, though in my naive terms, which I feel what caching is basically a saved answer to a question. And more technically, you know, delving into this thing, it is simply a local database or an in-memory store. So where you can, you know, keep the recently used objects or codes, anything, and you can access them later on without going into the actual source. Yeah, to like just cover up all these technical definitions or aspects, you all must be aware that Elon Musk and many other competitors are planning for expedition to Mars, you know, somewhere exploring the Mars in 20s, maybe later on. But I'm quite optimistic, very, very, actually very optimistic. In 2025, they might attain this dream. So what does this has to do with? So it's, again, just a simple concept. There was a boy who won a lottery. And so just imagine with me, okay? So you all are in 2025 right now, and then there's this guy, Elon Musk, who is like sending the spaceships or spacecrafts to Mars. Okay, so now there's this kid who has, you know, won a lottery, and he realizes that, yeah, after, so he realizes he wants to utilize his money properly. So what basically he plans to do is, he puts all the money along with him, and he's a little bit skeptical about keeping the money at home. You know, it might not be safe for him. So what he realizes is that he'll definitely lucratively spend all the money. But so the hot thing in 2025 is people going to Mars. So this boy decides that he definitely will travel to Mars as he has, you know, the won the lottery. But along with it, he'll take all the money and keep it on Mars and store it there. So whenever he needs it, he'll travel to Mars and get back. So do you think this is a good idea? The money will expire, like, I mean, within maybe 2-3 journeys to Mars. So it's insanely crazy. The idea, the concept is insanely crazy. So what, embed these concepts into the real caching world and understand that the boy himself is a computer or is an application, or basically it's a computer where he requests some kind of resource, and to request the resource, he doesn't have to go so far, like as far as Mars. He can store certain objects which are to be reused into his local home or the local memory, and he can reuse those objects and just use it. So this is the basic idea of what caching is. Just one simple note in between the talk. My talk is primarily intended to people who are just naive in Python or who are naive in computer science fields, because advanced talks are usually dealt with many other people. So yeah, for advanced people also, I feel there'll be something to learn, at least 1%. Let's see. Yeah, so the why of caching. Why do we need caching, basically? So the core reason is performance improvements. What I feel is all these three reasons, performance improvements and the remaining two, they all are aligned to each other. The first reason is performance improvement. Second is you clone the data, which is very expensive to look up. And there are too many requests or lookups which are constantly made to the server, which basically slow down the primary objective of application. So a simple example could be when you are like doing some server, you are just grabbing the data from the internet. You are like basically scraping the data. So you don't need to constantly, you know, do the same operations again and again on the server. You can basically cache that data somewhere and, you know, utilize it. So the primary objective of the application is preserved rather than, you know, doing it repetitively. And yeah, Phil Carlton is a great person. I mean, he's a computer scientist basically, and he's a very renowned person in computer industry. He says is there are only two hard things in computer science. One is in caching and cache invalidation, and the other one is naming things. So I'll come back to this topic in my later half of the talk. And yeah, so caching, it happens in two terms. One is local caching and another one is distributed caching. So I'll speak about the local topic, local caching from the ground level. So in local caching, you have a cache which is intended only to a single instance of application. The data, obviously, when you cache it, it has to be used further. So you always have some kind of reference to the data which you are storing. So obviously, when you talk about references, there is something called as dict in Python, that's dictionary. So you have always a key value pair. So value is your data, and a key is something which you are going to refer it to, you know, get the data back. So yeah, this pretty looks simple. Now I just want to, as we are dealing with caching, and caching primarily deals everything with dictionaries. So I would like to delve deeper into the dictionary part, but just one real example, one more real example of caching. So you have basic status codes, you know, as Narendran talked in his talk. So there are this status codes by the web applications, which we, when we request, you get sometimes. So 404 is something which is page not found, 200 is something which you properly receive the response. And have you heard about 304, anybody? Yeah, so 304, oh, good. So this 304 is basically something which is, you do not need to modify. So 304 is something which is already cached in your basic application. So when I was requesting XKCD, that's a very famous comic, I hope everybody is aware. If you're not, just check it out once. So this website is basically full of static web pages. So when I requested it for the first time, it definitely showed me a proper 200 response. But when I requested it again and again, it showed me 304. So that was the way I found out, oh yeah, there is something called as caching in web applications as well. I mean, there's a proper status code for caching as well. Yeah, so moving further, when you talk about local caching, there are various advantages and caveats. Obviously, when there are advantages, there'll be obviously some cons associated with it. The simplistic advantage is it's very simple and it's very fast. Whenever something is very simple, it intends to be very fast. So there are various caveats associated with it. First is the size of the cache. Now, when you talk about caching, now let's say if you have limited data, let's say it's hardly in KBs or something like that. When you want to cache that data, it becomes very easy. You just go on caching it. You just go on adding the data into the dict and associating it with a key. But now let's say if you have like millions or billions of data, how do you cache something like that? So that becomes very difficult because cache is an in-memory or a RAM. It basically uses the RAM, for storing the data, and you don't have that much amount of memory, to get all the data within the cache. So size is something which matters a lot when you consider local caching. But there are, various improvements. I'll go delve deeper into further. Then there's the state of So the state is basically there are two things associated with the state. One is the warm cache, and another is the local. Another one is the hot cache. So there's a warm cache and there's a cold cache. So warm cache is basically something when you have the data and it is going to be used. Cold cache is something the data may be stale, or it may be corrupted, or it may be crashed, or might be the data and it might not be present. So the state is something which is another factor. Like if you are requesting something from the cache and the data is not present in the cache, so it's like ultimately no benefits. So obviously to cater the needs of size, we definitely need to have an expiration policy. We can eliminate those data points which we are not going to use very frequently in the near time, in the near future. So I'll cover these concepts more into further slides. I hope the code is visible. If it is not, I've mentioned earlier the URL as well as there are screens. So just to quickly go into the code, it's a local cache and it's a very canonical example of caching. It's nothing, basically it's just using a dict in order to compute the length of the string, and we store that length into, we associate that length to particular keys. So that's it basically, nothing more. And so here you have sudo and pycon, those are two small strings. And you calculate the length we stored in the cache, and we retrieve it from cache again when we recall the compute length for S1, that's string 1. So this is a very canonical example, very basic one. And now let's delve, as I had said previously, we'll have to delve deeper into the dict part. So how dictionaries are implemented in Python is basically they use the underlying hash tables. The only reason which I find primarily of using hash tables is the lookup advantage which hash provides. It's O of 1 lookup. So yeah, that's and one more thing is when we perform a lookup, we index it on keys. So yeah, rather than saying just delve deeper, yeah. So this is the we are like going into the little bits of dictionaries. One point I'd like to mention is what is the primary goal of hash function? Anybody? I know it's visible on the slides, but just to generalize, anybody who can generalize these things? Oops. Yeah, please. Can you? It's okay. You can just hash function. Yeah. Yeah. Right. Exactly. So yeah, the goals as mentioned is when we distribute the keys evenly. So whenever you use a hash function, the primarily concept is that we should distribute the keys evenly. We should not have something which is colliding. Like let's say if we have two keys, and we should not have the same hash value for both the same keys. So that is something which is colliding. And we minimize, so to minimize the number of collisions, the hash function is used. And this is the pseudocode which I basically wrote by myself when I found the hash function for the strings, which was an actual C Python implementation. So what it basically does is if the hash value is already calculated, it just returns it. The hash is basically something for the string. So we have a string, we calculate the hash if it is all, so that's it basically. And what the function does is basically it calculates the string length, and it initializes a pointer to traverse to all the characters of the string. So we start from the first character and we traverse it till the end. Now what we do with each of these things is until and unless the entire string doesn't get completed, we have we set the variable. I mean, we take a random variable and we XOR it with the value pointed by p. P is basically a pointer to each character in the string, and we keep on incrementing the pointer, and we keep on storing the XOR values associated with the pointer into the variables. So after this loop is basically completed, we XOR again the x, which is, you know, finally derived with the length of the string object, and then we again cache it and return x as the hash. So that's basically how hash functions for strings work. One more point to note is I'm just considering the string factor right now. I'm not delving deeper into integers or anything like that, but we have similar functions for those data types as well. To provide a more data point, you can look into the actual CPython implementations for all these functions. This is the just a pseudocode of whatever it is present there. Okay, so to delve further into this thing, I'll so as I said, dictionaries are basically implemented using hash tables. Now, what we have in front of us is basically all of the four keys on the left-hand side need to be hashed and need to be stored into a hash table. So the first step, what it does is it calculates the hash of A, and we can see a 7. So 7 is basically the array size or the table size which we are using, and we just AND it with this and we store it. We basically use it as an index. We get the index and we store it into a particular index. So everything goes well when the data is consecutive. To like make it more clear, we can see it's A, B, C, and the values are 1, 2, 3. Values doesn't matter, it's just the keys basically. So whenever we introduce a new key, let's say Z, the data becomes inconsecutive and we fail here. So there's a collision. So what it happens is basically the hash of Z and the 7, it results into an index which points to 3, which is same as that of B. Now, in order to resolve such collisions, we have a collision resolution techniques. So the primarily technique which is used by hash functions in Python is open addressing. So what it does is basically it tries to calculate the hash and the table size minus 1, that's mask basically. And if we find a particular empty slot within the table, it just assigns it to it. If there is some collision, it probes for the next empty slot and then it assigns to it. So this is the overall gist of how the hashing happens behind the scenes under the dictionary. And yeah, so this is the actual CPython dictionary you can see. Just to provide more insights, the first struct you can see, this is basically the struct for each element within the dictionary. And as you can see, it has a hash, a key, and a value as the fields. And the second struct which you could see is the proper dict object. Now, just to make it more clear, this MA underscore fill is something which holds the used slots as well as the what you can say, the dummy slots. So basically the slots, I refer to all the tables to the right side, the hash tables. So use slot is something which is already occupied. Dummy slot is something which had been occupied and it is not being used currently. The data might not be present or it might not be used. It's stale basically. So MA underscore fill is the field which does that. MA underscore used is something which consists of only use slots. MA underscore mask is something which I talked earlier about the size. So what it does is basically a size minus 1, the array size or the table size minus 1. So that is the MA underscore mask field. MA underscore table is the entire table, whatever the data is present in the table is stored there. So this is basically a pointer to that thing. And this MA underscore lookup is a pointer to the lookup function, which is used to look up the keys within the hash table. And MA underscore small table, now the small table is very similar to table, only the difference is that small table stores just the initial values, whatever are present in the table. If you want to modify the table, whenever you modify the table, the values get reflected only in the MA underscore table. So this is something which is the underlying how the dict is present in the CPython. And this one more thing I just want to mention from the right hand side is there's this function pydict underscore set item. So the set item field also the underlying implementation, it uses a caching mechanism to get the value if the hash is present. So just a small snippet of code to like showcase the example of caching again. So there's a pretty interesting library out there called as cache tools. How many of you are aware about cache tools? Anybody? Okay, that's good. So what this library does is basically it is a wrapper to all the underlying caching algorithms which we might have studied, you know, in our in case if we have not studied the algorithms, I'll just mention is LRU, LFU. LRU is least recently used, LFU is least frequently used, RR is random replacement algorithm, and TTL is time to live. So just to provide a small short insight into all these algorithms, you can visit any of the operating systems concepts and you might get, you know, information about this. So yeah, coming back to cache tools, what cache tools does is it has basically classes for implementing caches using different caching algorithms. So there are various classes written in the cache tools library, and we can use it just as a wrapper, that is basically a decorator, and we can import the cache tools and we can use them as decorators as well. So it's similar to an API, basically nothing more. And yeah, so just providing a data point, I mean the code snippet for this thing. What I've done is I've done nothing big, it's just simple. We are caching 3-4 items. The only thing to note here is the as we have imported cache tools, we are using a function called as LRU cache. Basically it's a class. So and it has a max size associated with it. So there's a max size of 3 associated with it, which means that we can only store 3 items in the cache at a particular point of time. So you can see I have cache of PyCon. I don't want to delve deeper into this code because it's doing nothing, but okay. So there's PyCon and there's India as the key and a value, here and a value. And as you can see in the third line of the output basically, so let's go on to the second one, LRU cache, PyCon India, year 2018 and S date. So that is the point where you have max size equal to 3 and current size equal to 3. So when these two fields become equal, it is the time it realizes that we have to eradicate some values from the cache. So what it does is basically it eradicates it, since it's a LRU cache, so it eradicates the least recently used one and it inserts the new value, that is a cache of E date, at the point where it eradicated. So PyCon India is eliminated and a new E date, that's the end date, is basically inserted there. Now how it does is I'll explain it in next to next slide. Just one more small snippet of code which shows it's a basically a real-time example where everybody can use it. So it's a TTL cache I've used. So what this TTL cache does is basically there's a time associated with it. Three is basically the three times the responses are stored. After that the cache is cleared. There's no data in the cache. We'll have to again request it. So the canonical example for this, we can see the output. The first time it requests the URL, so it's not cached, hence it's fetching. So, and hence the response code of 200 is displayed, the accept block runs. So hence the response, first response is generated. When the next time it goes again, it doesn't run the accept block, it just runs the when it goes in try block, it understands that there's a cache, I mean there's already available data, so it provides the response for that. Similarly, we can go on, and at the third point, we say again it's not cached because the TTL has expired. The TTL basically decrements every time when you refer the cache. So that's the second example. Coming back to LRU cache, as I had previously mentioned, we'll delve deeper into the code which is actually written. So this is LRU cache is basically the the class which is implemented by somebody known as TKEM on GitHub. So it doesn't matter, but we have only two things to consider here in the entire code base. One is the pop item function, and the another one is the if block, that is a has attribute block and the pop item. So one more thing to mention here is this guy who has written this code has used collections.order.dict and not dict. So why such ambiguity? I mean, can anybody answer this question? Yeah. Correctly, right. Exactly. So just to provide more insights, collection.order.sec always maintains the order. Before Python 3.6, dict was unordered. After Python 3.6, the dict object itself has become ordered now. So I don't think there's a necessary for this, but this guy might have written the code earlier, hence. So just again coming back to the point of pop items and has attribute. Now we'll go back to this one. What it does is basically when max size and current size become equal, we call the code calls the pop item function. So the first element within the LRU cache. So the first one is basically the least recently used, hence it gets eliminated. So pop item is called and we eliminate that, and we insert this into the new, that's update function, which does that thing. Now, just to provide more insights into this, now as we have e-date out there, the key value end date. So that end date is basically the most recently used, not the least recently used, but it's the most recently used field right now. And hence we'll have to push that field again at the end. So what we do is here, we have a attribute with collections.orderDict that's moved to end. What it does is basically moves the recently inserted value to the end of the LRU cache. So when the next time again we run this LRU cache, what happens is this end date basically appears at the end, and there'll be year eliminated and there'll be new value inserted in place of year 2018. So yeah, that's the overall implementation of LRU cache. Now let's move on to memoization. I guess everybody is aware about this. Who is not aware about memoization? Okay, there are many. Okay. So memoization is nothing but it stores the intermediate results to avoid repeated computations. Okay, so you all must be wondering, cache also does the same thing, memoization is also doing the same thing. So what's the difference? The difference is the only two points which are, core difference between this. Memoization is more of utilizing or storing the functional calls which happen within a program, and caching is basically a more generalized version of everything. So you can cache anything basically, but memoization is a very pertaining to function calls, where you just store the function calls so that you do not have to again repeat executing the same functions. So so the one thing which has to be maintained is there always needs to be an input associated with the output. Whatever is the input, the output has to remain the same. So at that point of time only you can use memoization. If the output keeps changing, memoization might fail. And why of memoization? The block explaining expensive code is very similar to caching. The only reason we have a separate concept of memoization is the second block, that is a recursive code. So that is basically the only thing which has made memoization come into the picture. I don't want to delve deeper into the pseudocode. It's self-explanatory probably. And the only thing, the tree on the left side is something which is not memoized. So it's a canonical example of Fibonacci function. It's a top-down approach. So what we do is we calculate the Fibonacci at each stage, and there's a complete call stack which we can see out the on the left side, which is not memoized. But on the right side, if you can see, we have a memoized one, and the crosses is basically something which we have already cached. So we don't have to refer to, we don't have to execute the Fibonacci versions for the ones which are crossed out in the below part on the right hand side. So this is memoization. Yeah, I've just showed the similar example. What I've did is basically I've applied a timeit module to both the functions. The first function is underscore fib is basically something which is not memoized, and we have fib function which basically uses a decorator of memoization. And we can see at the very below of the screen, without memoization the output which appears, the time it takes is 4 units, and with memoization it takes 2 units. So it's 2x faster when we use memoization. So yeah, it's a good thing. And just to delve it into more deeper aspects of this code, what I have is disassembler. So there's a library called as DIS, that's a disassembler thing. What this library does is basically it provides the execution bytecodes for all the things happening in the code. So this is basically the output for the dis when we use it with underscore fib. On the similar basis, when we use it with Fibonacci function, which is memoized, you can see very limited instruction calls as compared to the one which was showed previously. and hence this works more better. I would like to skip functools. Functools is something which was introduced in Python 3.2. I don't think there was any need for this because there was already cache tools out there. It does the same thing. It uses LRU cache. Okay, so just 2 minutes more. Yeah, sure, that's what. So I'm out of time basically, but I tried to explain local caching. There was distributed caching which is missing. So yeah, just to give a quick overview, distributed caching uses Memcached and Redis. We can use Redis as well. Memcached is something which is more simplistic. I would like to skip the slides as we have less time. Just a last thing about Memcached is something which does not return all the keys within a list. So in order to get we cannot get any time all the keys in the list, but there's this API function in PHP which shows get all the keys. And ironically, in the later part you can see this is not an atomic operation. As Memcached doesn't guarantee to return all the keys, you cannot assume that all the keys have to be returned. So if the if the API is not guaranteeing we have to return all the keys, there's no need of making that API basically. That's it. Just one point. There's a very detailed introduction about Cache Me If You Can by this guy. He has a proper talk. So if you want to refer more about Memcached, you can just refer his talk. Thank you, everybody.